All right, welcome to our lunch event today. it's great to have you here today with us. My name is Guntram Wolf, and I'm the director of Brügel, and I'm very happy today to welcome you to this event on the topic of stability of EMU and prospects for fiscal union. Now, the event is centered around a recent report published by Fundación ICO and Fundación de Estudios Financieros, Euro 2015, yearbook. It is a collection of a number of papers by a number of excellent scholars, including one of Brügel scholars, Alicia Garcia Herrero, who is a senior fellow at Brügel. She wrote here on the sustainability of monetary union as seen by the emerging economies. But of course, the main person who worked on this entire book and edited it also and wrote the executive summary is here today with us, Fernando Fernandez, and he will do the main presentation of the report today. The plan is that, so after my opening remarks, which are about to be finished, I will give the floor to Javier Méndez Hiera, who's the executive director of the Fundación de Estudios Financieros, so one of the two foundations that have published this report, also for just a quick welcoming and opening. And then we give to Fernando Fernandez. My colleague Pierre Hüttel, who's affiliate fellow here at Brügel, will chair the subsequent discussion, which will be a discussion among those here on the panel, including Fernando Navarrete, Chief Financial Officer of Instituto de Crédito Oficial, and of course José Leandro, who I think is well known also in this house. José Leandro is director in DG ECFIN and one of the, can I say, masterminds behind the Five Presidents report. Thinking deeply about governance and further development of fiscal union. And so let me just thank all of you for having come here today. And let's wish us a very good discussion. I will also participate, of course, in the discussion. And I think, again, thank you for also putting together such a lovely volume. Unfortunately, we cannot discuss all the different chapters, but I think the focus on fiscal policy, fiscal union, is certainly a very interesting one.
Absolutely. Good morning to everybody. I'm going to be very, very brief. Just a few remarks about this book, which we'll be presenting today as part of the conference, as part of this extremely interesting conference we will be holding here at Brügel. 5 years ago, the Foundation for Financial Research in Spain, working with Professor Fernando Fernandez on what we initially named as the architecture of the euro, started all the work we've been developing afterwards. As part of that, we went over to work over the complex relationships between debt and currency impacts, right in the front of the euro crisis a few years ago. We realized that there were so many issues surrounding this that we decided to provide a further comprehensive framework for research going forward. And this is how the yearbook was born. For that matter, it became crucial the interest showed the help and the understanding of a former president of ICO, Instituto Crédito Oficial, Mr. Román Escolano. So we joined forces with them in the deep understanding that there was a huge work that lied ahead in order to explain policymakers, but most importantly, to transmit to Spanish society as a whole the enormous benefits and risks surrounding our common currency. Bearing in mind, of course, that we were strong believers of the euro's case. Specifically, we were also in a period of great difficulty coming from political impacts throughout the whole of Europe, misunderstanding, populist pressures, lack of knowledge, of technical knowledge, etc. So we really do expect it to help sort out this lack of understanding, carrying out each and every year a thorough analysis of what the euro means, but critically, what it still needs to be done to fully bear the fruits of its positives. Thank you, Guntram. Thanks very much to Bruegel for providing us, the Fundación ICO, Fundación de Estudios Financieros, with the chance of making this presentation along the debate, along this very interesting debate we'll be holding today. I really hope that you enjoy it. Thanks a lot. I think it's your turn.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Guntram. Thank you, Javier. First of all, let me apologize for my voice. I suffer from a cold. This is typically what happens when we try to come to Europe from southern, sunny Spain. So you will have to excuse my voice. I hope I can finish by the end of the day.
We apologize for the weather.
By the way, it was colder in Madrid than it is here in Brussels. So that wasn't the problem. Anyway. It's a privilege to be here once again. We had the opportunity to present this yearbook last year, where Guntram actually had a paper on the book. So we've tried every year since the very beginning to incorporate different participants in which is a collective book on the developments in the euro. We did, I think, the probably the most remarkable thing about the book is that it's been out for 5 years in a row, which is something not very usual in any academic endeavor, I should say. So the fact that we can now have a full 5-year series, it's interesting to see what we thought EMU would develop in 5 years and what actually has happened. And I will talk a little bit about it. As I said, 5 years have passed since the original report. The achievement of presenting the report for 5 years in a row is only equivalent to the achievements that have happened in EMU. I mean, who would have guessed 5 years ago that we would now sit in Brussels discussing the euro with a single banking supervisor in place, with a single resolution mechanism for all European banks in place, that we would have strengthened fiscal discipline in the euro area, developing a preventive arm for the as the Stability and Growth Pact, put in place a bailout mechanism for countries in distress, and even launch a permanent European Fiscal Stabilization Mechanism, the EMS. You know, all this is imperfect. All this could have been done better and faster, and I'm sure all of us here have ideas of how we could have done it differently. But we should also reflect on the fact that all this has happened in a remarkable short amount of time. I was joking with Fernando Navarrete on the plane coming here. The first time I mentioned the World Banking Union and mutualization of debt in Frankfurt in 2012, remember, it was a seminar where you and I were present in the Minister of Finance, and you could imagine that the reception to the word mutualization of banking debt coming from somebody in Spain at the height of the banking crisis was very easy to describe. I mean, it was immediately uproar. And a very prominent political figure in Germany at the time, by the way, is still present, stood up, took the phone and said, I will dedicate the rest of my life to make sure the banking union doesn't happen. To which I immediately stood up and said, I am confident that you will dedicate the rest of your life to make sure that then social tensions and all sorts of political havoc does not happen in Europe, because that will be the only natural consequence of not having a banking union. So I think we've avoided that. We have advanced and progressed significantly towards banking union and fiscal union. Yet, it is undoubtedly that there is a growing sense of dissatisfaction with the state of the union, a sense of failure, which Brexit, it's only a very open manifestation. Despite the economic recovery being a reality, with the euro area once growing again and creating employment, public perception of the recovery is far from positive, and a sense of defeat is probably the best way to describe the current mood in Europe. The reason for this, as you know, are many. Subdued growth and slow employment creation, excessive deflation concerns, in my view, unjustified expectations on real convergence and the persistent inability to ensure that countries remain roughly on par in terms of growth and income, balance of payments, and particularly employment figures. And above all, a growing dissatisfaction with the European project. Not surprising, given that most countries still refer to the Euro project in their national political debate as an external restriction, as an imposition from abroad. It's very difficult to make anything popular if those who are supposed to defend it always use it as the excuse for whatever bad things have to happen in a particular country. So I think that one of the lessons that we draw from the very first year report of the Euro is that unless we are proud of what we're doing and we sell what we're building with enough conviction, it will be very difficult for the people at large to accept that we're doing something that's worthwhile. The problem today also is that because of every other political events that you're all aware, the refugee crisis most likely, the euro is no longer a priority. Nobody seems to be willing to waste any additional political influence on an arcane subject that is no longer a concern. Once market pressure happens to have faded away, political willingness to complete what is still unfinished business seems to have evaporated. We ran again the risk of complacency, and this is unfortunately one of the main conclusions of the 2015 yearbook, which ends up in a little pessimistic tone compared to some of the previous books. The pessimism coming from the idea that once again we may stop short of finalizing a process of banking and fiscal union and economic union, which is a pity having moved so far, so much in such a short period of time. But we failed to find enough political consensus to finalize it. Anyway, the yearbook pursues a double objective, as usual, explaining what is happening and attempting to influence on the next steps to take. And these dual goals are important. I think one of the problems with the Euro project is that very little is known outside the sort of arcane world of experts, of those who attend the same seminars, the same conference, discuss among themselves the issues. But when you try I run this experiment every year. I teach at a business school in Madrid, and we have a lot of international students. It's one of the, let me do my 10 minutes of publicity, one of the top 10 business schools in Europe. And every year I do the same exercise. I ask students from outside Europe, what do you think of the euro? What is the euro? What is European Monetary Union? You will be surprised. You will be extremely surprised how little is known. People have not a clue of what we're trying to build in Europe. Of course, one can complain that this is because the Americans are stupid, which we all know is the case. And the Latin America has been particularly even more stupid, which, of course, being Southern Americans, then what could you be but stupid? But the fact is that we don't do a good job in explaining what we're building. And I think that part of the problem in Europe and part of the reason for a book like this is to make sure that we try to explain to the population at large, beyond our conferences and seminars and professional backgrounds, what is that we're trying to build, which is, by the way, something extraordinary new in political history. I mean, there has never been the case where 18 democratic countries, or X number of the X plus one every year, democratic member states or countries decide to put together and agree on a path of monetary union. Anyway, so this is what we try to do in this book. But we also try to influence on what is happening because the euro is, as I said, an unfinished product and there are many things that need to be complete. And this is what I will dedicate 5 to 10 minutes on some of the main lessons. Rapidly before that, the book is for those of you who have the lucky to have it, the book is structured in three different blocks. The first block is what I would call monetary union business as usual, and which it will describe anything that would have to be commented on any monetary union in the world, what you would talk about in the US euro dollar monetary union. This is what is the use of the common currency. How is credit, deposits, wealth, the use of the currency as a means of exchange, what is the exchange rate, the typical. Then we have a lot of relaxation of monetary policy. of course, monetary policy in this particular year, 2015, being one of the most significant new developments in the euro, in the euro area, where the ECB has behaved like any other central bank. Surprisingly enough, that has resulted very controversial, which is something that always escapes me. Why doing what everybody else does is so controversial in Europe. And maybe we have to talk a little bit about what is the institutional background and institutional setting in which the ECB operates, and why it's so difficult for a European Central Bank to conduct normal monetary policy, and faces difficulties that no other central bank in the world does, but this is what we cover in this section. The second part of the book is about institutional change, what things are new, and this is what we describe at some length, in particular the single supervision mechanism and the creating of a single common European supervision for all banks in Europe. We describe the process and what I think it can undeniably be described as a success. In a very short time, we were able to put together in Europe a common supervision for all banks, of course, with all sorts of problems, with all sorts of imperfections and things to be improved. But the fact is that it has worked, and I think I can talk from the point of view of the industry here too, has worked remarkably well. Second, we talk about, in that section, we talk about the single resolution mechanism and some of the issues pending, and of course, capital markets union as the leg left in the table for the table to be sustainable and fruitful in the future. Now, the third part of the book discusses weird things, strange things, long-term questions that one should know. One of the weird things that we talk about, for instance, is sovereign default mechanisms. Does the euro need a sovereign default mechanism system? What are the pros and cons? What are the advantages and the disadvantages? It also discusses the role of European institutions in managing national economic and financial crisis. Once again, we did it a little bit last year with the example, and that's where Guntram's paper was on, and we go on involving somebody. We wanted this paper to be written by somebody from outside Europe, so we asked a hedge fund manager in the US to talk about Angel Uribe, who is also a Peterson's Institute fellow, to comment on how is it working, this mechanism to deal with crisis. And then we talk about Brexit, which we always have a chapter on political issues, because we, from the very beginning, believe that the euro is a political process, and it cannot be understood without that fact. What are the main findings? Let me summarize, for the sake of the discussion, 5 to 6 quick points. First, financial fragmentation. The good news is financial fragmentation has declined, has clearly diminished. All indicators, both of prices and quantities, volumes in financial fragmentation in the euro area have declined in 2015. This is the good news. The even better news is that all indicators of financial fragmentation showed very little uptick at the height of the Greek crisis in the summer. So there seems to be a good umbrella resulting on the combination of banking union and concerted action of the ECB. And that has worked reasonably well in isolating from contagion in difficult stress situations. And I think this is the good news. The bad news is, though, that financial integration is still short from the levels that were reached in Europe in 2008, before the crisis. The levels of integration in different segments of the financial markets in Europe is still way below what it was before the crisis, which probably means that some of the changes in the behavior of agents, market agents, has been more permanent than anticipated. The risk aversion has increased for the long haul, and the domestic bias is becoming much more resilient in the mind of investors than we thought. Additional improvements in financial integration will require, then, the removal of any lingering doubts about the mutualization of bank and sovereign debt and major advancements towards fiscal union. and capital markets union. That's one of the main conclusions of the book. If we really want to go back to the levels of financial integration experienced in the Eurozone before the crisis, we have to dispel the doubts that the crisis put on the table in terms of the probability of shared risks within the Eurozone. Second conclusion, monetary policy. Monetary policy has been a success. Extraordinary monetary policy, ultra-loose monetary policy has been a success. It has prevented the debt crisis from imploding. It has probably been instrumental in restoring growth in Europe, but it has done so at a great risk, at the risk of granting the European Central Bank dangerous level of activism, forcing it to reach quasi-fiscal decisions, and placing the ECB firmly in the midst of controversy, jeopardizing potentially its independence. So monetary policy is a success, but monetary policy has been extraordinarily loose in a period that is not so extraordinary anymore. A policy of quantitative easing is a sophisticated means of financial repression by keeping returns on savings artificially low. In effect, it entails a transfer of income from those who save to those who rely on debt. A transfer which raises not only ethical problems, but also functional dilemmas. A dilemma concerning its effectiveness over time. How is Europe expected to recover the rest of investment, growth, and employment without savings? Particularly when we look at economies in which the debt of public sector and private agents is already at an all-time high, or close to all-time highs. If this extremely heterodox monetary policy persists for too long, it risks generating perverse incentives. There are growing indications that this may be the case. Some of the most obvious negative effects of this ultra-loose monetary policy are well known. Some of them have already commented. But lately, it's coming to the attention the dangers that it may create on the long-term health of the financial system. I was particularly interested by reading yesterday a conference by the president of the BIS, the secretary general, what do we call it? Carbona? Carbona is the president, right? The president of the Bank of International Settlement, so complaining particularly on the negative impact on the health of the financial system that a persistent long-term period of negative interest rates may create. And this happens, by the way, at a time where I'm surprised to read almost every day on the Financial Times a couple of articles by very sophisticated economists telling us how is it possible to continue endlessly with negative interest rates, how effective they are, how there's no zero bound in its effectiveness, and how we can be so creative as to make sure that banks end up being an instrument to distribute wealth from the government to the taxpayer and forget anything that has to do with intermediating on financial markets. That is something of the past, it appears to be. Well, it seems to be very difficult to conceive a functioning monetary union, but it seems to be, to me, very difficult to conceive a functioning monetary policy in any monetary arrangement where banks are not banks anymore. This is the third point I wanted to discuss. Third, on the role of the ECB as a bank supervisor, as I said, it is unquestionably a success in a very short period of time. There, of course, still remain some national regulatory exceptions, but we have essentially created the elements for a common level playing ground among banks, which makes comparison in Europe now possible. It's not perfect, but it is possible. And it's clearly much better than it was. And the ECB has taken, in its supervisory branch, it has clearly taken this as a goal. I mean, to continue reducing national differences and national regulatory legacy positions. It will not be easy. It will never be fair because each country will protect a little longer its own national particular circumstances and make sure that everybody else becomes into the mainstream sooner than the other. But I think this is a good process. And it has led to a very important cultural change in many jurisdictions in banking supervision. Banking institutions were in general in Europe accustomed to a supervision based exclusively on their compliance with Basel regulatory requirements and capital and liquidity. In a welcoming contrast, the ECB has branched out into new supervisory fields, assessing things like corporate governance, the quality of underlying data, the management of risk and not simply its measurement, the assessment of business models, and even questioning future profitability of the different banks. This place, the supervisory, this is a welcome position in my view, but also a dangerous one. It places the supervisor in an uncertain position in which it must proceed with great caution, especially when we consider that some of these issues are core competences of the governing bodies of financial institutions, which are, at the end, under normal circumstances, responsible for managing the institution. The new supervisory model has increased the discretionary authority of the supervisor. However, and this is probably a welcome concern, a welcome development, and probably my personal view, and in the view of the authors of those two chapters, something that was necessary. However, discretion must be accompanied by transparency, predictability, and accountability. The supervisor has to become used to be also accountable and predictable. Moreover, the speed of the regulatory change has probably been excessive. We need to take a break and make sure the banks understand what supervisory requirements they are asked to meet and how they can plan their strategies over the medium term in a stable regulatory environment. Banking for very quickly, the European resolution mechanism. Let me just, because I don't want to talk too long. Let me just mention that this has been a surprising development, very positive. Yet, the approved framework leaves three questions in my mind unanswered. First, the phasing-in period of 2 years is way too long. Way too long. Of course, we're all counting on the idea that if need be, it will be advanced. It will be phased in earlier. But this is, again, I think, unsatisfactory to count on. If there is a crisis and when there is a crisis, then we'll do things differently. We should have learned better by now. Second, the fund, the European Resolution Fund, may prove too small. And what's more important, the capacity to leverage itself too limited. And what to me is crucial, subject to too many conditions. If the fund is to be, has to be used and leveraged, it will be overnight. And we won't have many luxury opportunities to discuss the details. So it would have been good to do it like that. Third, there is excessive restrictions to the fiscal backstop. And without a fiscal backstop, no resolution mechanism can be fully reliable. No fiduciary financial system has ever worked in the world without a fiscal backstop. Europeans tend to think that we're different, but so far nobody has been able to come out with a fiduciary system. Yeah, 2 minutes, probably less than 2 minutes. Just fiscal governance. On fiscal governance, not much has happened in 2015. And therefore, the same problem remains. The basic problem in my mind is that we've created a system that is so cumbersome that nobody understands it. It's very difficult to explain to the population at large who is responsible for what on fiscal issues. And fiscal sovereignty is, by definition, one of the most important, I was going to say, fundamental ingredients of a member state, of sovereignty. Now, if we do not know who's responsible for what on fiscal issues, it's very difficult to make this system understandable and then popular. Let me underline quickly three things that we're still missing in fiscal union for the sake of discussion. A European Treasury functioning? How long can we pretend that we can work without a European Treasury? A real macroeconomic stabilization capacity at the core of the union, and the existence of a European risk-free asset, which is necessary for the conduct of monetary policy. And I always make the same point, that one of the main differences between the ECB and the Fed is that the Fed intervenes, it just decides how much wants to buy and what maturity it wants to buy. When the ECB decides to intervene in the market, it has to decide which paper, which country it buys. And this is a mess. And we are working under the presumption that it doesn't matter, but it does matter. It clearly does matter, as anybody sitting in the ECB understands. Last point, the restructuring of European debt. It's no small matter. There is no comparable international mechanism, and the IMF's effort to create one for the world has been ineffective. Nevertheless, I think there are too many economists in Europe and around the world that seem to be thrilled with the fact that we in Europe may be the first to create a European restructuring mechanism, that sovereign debt restructuring mechanism. Let me just make a quick point. A system of almost complete national fiscal autonomy with no European bailout mechanism is theoretically possible. It actually was the system designed in the Maastricht Treaty. It was how the Union was supposed to work up until in 2010 we discovered that it would break up the Union apart and we created a bailout mechanism. Basically because we decided that the probability of having credit events, sovereign credit events, and the likelihood of those credit events becoming unmanageable was just a price we were not willing to pay. So I'm a little puzzled that we now, 5 years later, are rediscovering the will and want to create a system that will make credit events, sovereign credit events, more often and more frequent and less different. In my view, it's much better to work on the other line. The other line would be to limit the fiscal autonomy of the parties involved in exchange for a bailout mechanism. The problem is that the procedure to limit this fiscal sovereignty must be known in advance with clear rules and decision-making arrangements, the institutions in charge of the mechanism fully empowered and accountable, and in addition, the ultimate credible sanction needs to be present in the system. And the ultimate sanction can only be expulsion from the monetary union or the surrender of fiscal sovereignty to the European authorities. Because making sovereign credit episodes more frequent is no alternative. With that very drastic comment, which sounded a lot harsher than I wanted, than I intended to, but I don't want to take too much time, but I'm sure we already made the debate.
Thank you, Fernando.
So thank you, and sorry to come out so blunt and drastic.
No problem. Well, there is time. Thank you for these comments. Thank you for the presentation of the report and this great overview of the whole report. And also thank you for introducing the focus, I would say, of the panel discussion, which is more on fiscal union. And we will come back to your last comments more in detail, and you will have possibility to explain. I would give now the floor to the panelists and ask each of them to talk for about 5 minutes so that we will have afterwards a nice interactive discussion. And I would start with Leandro. Thank you, José.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. First, I must say that this is quite an impressive report from its breadth and its depth. I think it's one of the few studies that I made with such prominent people writing about Eurozone in such a broad way and covering all the aspects. So I think this type of work is very welcome. It's a very high quality work. Because of its breadth, let me just focus on a few topics that I think are important from my perspective and more linked to the topic of fiscal union. So we are in a monetary union that is very sui generis. Compared to other monetary unions, we don't have large fiscal transfers. We don't have mechanisms of adjustment like movement of labor mobility is relatively limited within the monetary union compared to other monetary unions around the world. And these two things make for the fact that we need to have a construction that makes sure that the members of the monetary union are able to absorb shocks individually by pursuing the right policies, by building fiscal buffers in good times so that they can absorb the shocks in bad times and let the automatic stabilizers work when shocks come. Having flexible labor markets, efficient product markets, so that these economies are able to absorb these shocks individually. However, and this was, I think, the concept behind the Maastricht Treaty, that each one of the member states would have to absorb the shocks individually, right? And then you have the rules to avoid moral hazard, free riding, and destabilizing behaviors, right? It didn't work. It didn't work because it's clear that in a monetary union, you do not only need to have the member states with the ability to absorb shocks individually, some shocks need to be shared, right? Because otherwise, the system does not work. And in fact, you create situations, and we have seen them between 2008 and 2012, where the automatic stabilizers were overwhelmed by the crisis. Even the member states which had space were not able to use it because they were overwhelmed. And this created systemic issues for the whole and through contagion, mainly through the financial sector. So you need mechanisms for risk sharing. Now, there are two ways of doing risk sharing. One is public sector risk sharing, mainly fiscal. And the other is private sector risk sharing through capital markets, credit markets. Now, in the US, for example, most of the risk sharing is done through the private channel, capital markets, credit markets. And basically, these absorb 80% of a shock, which means that, for example, a 1% decline in GDP only leads to a decline of 0.2 percentage points in consumption because 0.8 is absorbed by mainly private sector risk sharing. And only a small part is done through fiscal transfers. In the euro area, we have a situation with only 40% of the risk sharing is done in total, and the public sector risk sharing is very small in there. So basically, we absorb half of the risks than the US does, and within that, we don't have capital markets and capital markets able to absorb through the private channel, and we don't have fiscal transfers or a stabilization function to absorb on the public sector side. Now, how to deal with this? I think, in our perspective, this fiscal union issue is part of the answer. But in terms of the sequencing, this is probably not the most urgent. The most urgent is probably to complete the financial union, the banking union, capital markets union, and front-load the private sector risk sharing, and link the public sector risk sharing through the fiscal to further integration of fiscal governance. That's the logic in the Five Presidents report. Front load private sector risk sharing through completion of the banking union and launching of the capital markets union, and backload fiscal union through the stabilization function, the macro stabilization function, and link that to more integration on the fiscal governance. That's the logic. Now, it's true that since the report was published, probably the agenda has been overtaken by other more urgent issues. The migration is, of course, the one that makes the headlines every day, the refugee issues. And so we are in a kind of a situation that is probably more dangerous than during the crisis, because there is a sense of complacency on these matters of the economic and monetary union. There's a sense of, okay, we have more important things to deal with. We can put that in the back burner, right? I think this is a mistake. And it's probably more dangerous than what we had in the period until 2012, 13. We are kind of in a situation where we're suffering from a slow-boiling frog type of problem. If you have a boiling water and you throw a frog in the boiling water, the frog jumps out and it survives. If you put the frog in cold water and you increase the temperature slowly, it will not jump out. It will stay there until it dies. And that's, I think, the risk that we face currently, right? So I think having this debate on this issue and keeping pushing for these ideas is very important in a context. Let me just make another final point on this, and then I stop. It's on the sovereign debt restructuring issue. It's mentioned in the papers, and it's also mentioned in a paper that Guntram and Agnès Benassi and Xavier Rago have published recently. Theoretically, I think, yes, makes sense. In practice, I think this is a very dangerous proposal. Not in itself, but if it's sequencing in the wrong way. A sovereign debt restructuring mechanism makes sense once you have completed the banking union, once you have in place a risk-free or a risk-free asset for the Eurozone as a whole, then you can think of introducing a sovereign debt restructuring mechanism, but not before. Why? Because sovereign debt is the reference asset for the financial sector. And it's the reference in terms of it sets the price for all the other assets in the financial system. And if you mess up with the risk-free, the perception of risk-free, of this asset, without having something that replaces it, you may create huge instability in the system. So if this thing is sequencing in the wrong way, before you have in place the stabilization tools to deal with a situation like that through a complete banking union that includes also a deposit insurance scheme, you may be creating more problems than solutions. So let me stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for these thoughts. And I would like Javier, please, to follow up on that. Sorry, yes.
Okay. Yeah. So thank you for Bruegel giving us the opportunity to present this joint endeavor of Fundación ICO, Fundación de Estudios Financieros, about the Euro Yearbook. And I think it's a very good occasion for discussing in connection with the specific topic of fiscal union. I think José Leandro has made an excellent presentation on strategy matters and how to phase in or phase out the different parts of further economic integration within the monetary union. So we have not talked before this this seminar, but I think you'll realize that we our thinking is very well aligned, and I'll go more into the details why I think what he has done in terms of strategy makes a lot of sense. So basically what I would do is to concentrate which are the fiscal consequences or the fiscal dimensions of a banking union project. Going more into the details, and I think you realize that the strategy he has outlined for a much broader economic policy makes a lot of sense. So I'll start saying a complete banking union has very sui generis fiscal consequences. Of course, banking union, please don't get me wrong, a banking union is much more than just fiscal consequences or fiscal impacts, and Fernando Fernandez has mentioned many of those. But I will not concentrate on those, not because I think they are irrelevant. I think they are the most relevant, so financial stability, financial integration, completion of the single market, that's the most important, but also it has fiscal consequences. And I will concentrate just for the matter of this presentation on this limited, let's say, limited approach. So from a purely narrow fiscal perspective, a complete banking union has distinctive features that, in my view, make it, as of today, the most powerful and desirable form or instrument of fiscal union that is both politically and financially feasible today. So which are those characteristics? First, I would argue it's a contingent fiscal union. That is to say that it only activates its stabilizing and redistributing capacities when it is most needed. That is to say, only in the case of a systemic banking crisis, and it's only activated under those circumstances. As a consequence of its contingent nature, there is no ex-ante correlation whatsoever between income levels in a certain jurisdictions and the probability of a certain jurisdiction, taxpayer or depositor ending up being a net receiver or a net payer of the whole mechanism. So exposed taxpayers or depositors located in jurisdictions in which the fiscal cost of a banking crisis happens to be, as a percentage of GDP, of course, happens to be larger than in other countries, will end up being exposed net receivers. But this can happen and has effectively happened basically in rich or poor countries on a, let's say, purely a random matter. Just a mere example, this is just a mere example. If a complete banking union system had been in place since the Eurozone inception, other things being equal, this is a harsh assumption, other things being equal, but this is just an example. For example, German or Dutch taxpayers or depositors would have clearly benefited in net terms from it. Why? Well, it's very simply. Just because the cost of banking crisis happening in those jurisdictions happened to be greater in terms of GDP than in other countries. Is this good or bad? Well, this is neutral. It's a fact. The third point, how powerful this instrument of stabilization is. Well, I'm arguing here, based on several research papers, that the stabilizing powers of a complete banking union, when activated, really dwarfs any other known fiscal instruments available. Just an example, again. In the case of an almost perfect banking union, which is the U.S. banking system, transfers received between federal states through banking resolution and deposit insurance mechanisms by has been extremely high. Just some examples. Federal states most severely hit by the real estate banking crisis in 2008-2009, like, for example, Nevada or Florida, just to give a couple of examples. The amount of net transfers they receive from the rest of the nation through deposit insurance and banking resolutions amount up to 20% of their regional GDP. This is massive. Can you imagine any fiscal transfer on that side of any traditional fiscal policy? I think this is really
unimaginable, and in the context of the European Union, simply out of sight. Why is this possible? Why nobody in the US, in, let's say, in California, is complaining why 20% transfer received by people in Nevada, depositors in Nevada or in Florida? Well, I think this is politically very important, because as this is not a recurrent systematic transfer system, quite on the contrary, as I mentioned, it's purely contingent, and it's only activated from 20 years in 20 years' time, hopefully if the supervisory environment is good enough, the governance of it can be basically rules-based, and it's not politically driven. Which rules am I talking about? Well, the rules of banking resolution and restructuring mechanism. We already have them in place. So it has a lot of political advantages for having it in place. Fifth point, as you may have noticed from the four previous points, the fiscal features of a banking union resembles more the characteristics of a fiscal atom bomb and not those of a precision-guided policy tool able to micromanage aggregate demand imbalances within a monetary union. Is this bad? I would say quite the contrary. This is quite good. The ex-ante role of banking union is basically to deter financial fragmentation, as Fernando Fernandez mentioned. But what is the benefits from that? If it's successful as a deterrence instrument, clearly we can save all the associated fiscal costs associated with skyrocketing sovereign borrowing costs. But just imagine, because sometimes mutual assured destruction doesn't work, so deterrence fails, and we have to activate it. What happens if it's activated? Well, its ex-post role would be to really stabilize markets through a true mutualization of very high banking restructuring costs. And this is a mechanism that has showed that it's able to cope with that amount of transfers that are associated. We might be tempted to ignore the fiscal positive impact of the deterrence role. Why? Maybe because it's unobservable. If it's successful, we don't observe the counterfactual. But these cost savings might be very high and permanent if they allow the risk premia not to be affected by the black swan of financial fragmentation being repeated again into the future. And when we're talking vis-a-vis foreigners, people in Japan, investors in Japan, in the US, this is a black swan that is really... they've learned the lessons about Europe being fragmented. So some part of the risk premium is in there. So we have to try to deter it and take it out of the equation once again. Well, but for all of the above to hold, I think it's imperative for the banking union to be completed, to be really completed. What is missing, I think both previous speakers have mentioned, we need a fully mutualized fiscal backstop. Otherwise, we have many of the ingredients, but the key one, I'm afraid it's still missing. We can call it many ways. Single deposit insurance scheme. Unlimited capacity by the single resolution fund to borrow with a joint guarantee by all Eurozone sovereigns. Or we can call it direct recapitalization by the ESM. We can invent many acronyms as we want. The underlying thing is a mutual fiscal backstop. So any other policy formulation might be well for politics. Policy making, that's good, but the underlying feature is the same. Of course, the natural counterpart of this shared bill footing would be mutual federal oversight of the banking system and its resolution. There is no way to escape from this. The funny thing is that we have the latter. We have the sovereignty sharing embedded in the SSM and the ESRM, but the funny thing, again, is that we do not have what we are paying the price for. What we don't have is the joint fiscal backstop. This is very weird from a political perspective. The momentum for culminating the banking union is waning, as José Leandro has mentioned. But not doing it is something we will lament during the next financial crisis, and there will be one. I'm sorry to say this. Be sure of that. We don't know how, and we don't know when, but it will come. So let us hope we will be better prepared for that time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. On these thoughts on the fiscal shock absorber called banking union. Please, Guntram.
OK,
Okay, thank you very much. So a lot has been said, so let me try to be short. I think the expression sui generis that was now used several times, you know, was wondering what exactly is meant, but I think José sort of gave the example of the frog slowly boiling, and I was wondering whether that was what is really meant. Now, talking about fiscal union, and it's a wide area, and in this panel we have mostly focused on the sort of the fiscal implications of banking union, a topic on which we already had a piece, I think, in 2012 for the informal ECOFIN, in which we indeed argued that, you know, to fully establish a fiscal backstop to a banking union, one would have to agree on a very significant mutualization of potential risks. And of course, the road chosen subsequently was to do basically banking union through private sector involvement. So basically to say we have bail-in rules that are extremely strict, and that means that there's basically no fiscal cost of banking crisis. The costs are all with the creditors of banks. And when you talk to European parliamentarians, what they told you when the BRRD was sort of finished, the Bank Resolution and Recovery Directive, they told you it's over, no more bailouts of banks. And of course, that's still the official line, and we haven't tested it, right? I mean, so we see that there's a few instances where we have had policy debates, including in the Italian banking system, where there was attempts to water that down, but the state aid rules were still relatively strictly implemented, and so we have not had outright state aid that, you know, would involve a significant fiscal cost so far since the BRRD is in place. Now, the problem is we also haven't had a systemic banking crisis, which means, so far what we have done is worth as much as the ink on the paper on which we have written it and, you know, the strength of our institutional setup. But my very deep conviction is that if we have another big systemic crisis, we will change that rule, and we will find ways of bailing out the banking system, which then again puts, of course, the fiscal question at the center of the banking union discussion. So in that sense, I would say I agree with the direction taken here that a complete banking union needs some form of a deposit, European deposit reinsurance system. I don't think you need the first insurance level at the European level, but a reinsurance, I think, is needed. And I also agree with the statement that we have an inconsistency in the sense we have a common supervision, centralized supervision, but we have a decentralized deposit insurance system. And I think this is ultimately an unsustainable system for a number of reasons. The first reason is very simple, straightforward, political. If we have a major bank going bust and drawing on the deposit insurance, the national one, why would the national deposit insurance have to accept a liability for a failure of supervision done in Frankfurt? I mean, this is, I think, it's just inconsistent as a system. It's unimaginable that this works. I also think that that is one of the reasons why the single supervisor has not yet fully ended the practice of national ring fencing, be it on the deposits or be it on capital for banks operating across borders. So we still do have that phenomenon that deposits as well as capital is not shifted freely around the Eurozone from different subsidiaries or branches of banks, because the supervisor is not ending the practice that we had pre-creation of SSM, and the SSM is not doing it because we do not yet have a fully centralized system where the fiscal backstop is is mutualized, or at least the reinsurance is mutualized. So I think we are in an awkward situation, and we will have to develop either in one direction or in the other. If we want to complete banking union, we will have to find that reinsurance system. And that is what is, of course, currently one of the big debates. And I think the Commission was right to come out with a paper on creating a European deposit insurance or reinsurance system. So much for that. Now, there's lots of other topics we can discuss. Let me talk about quickly two more points. One is this whole issue of the sovereign debt restructuring, since José also made reference to it, and the third point is fiscal stabilization, and perhaps I start with a stabilization point very quickly. I think when I think of stabilization, it's of course one of the three fundamental functions of fiscal policy. According to Musgrave, we have stabilization, allocation, and redistribution. All three are relevant policies that fiscal policy is undertaking. Now, I think the case for redistribution in the Eurozone is really quite small. A monetary union does not require permanent transfers from some parts to another. The case for allocation, I think, is much stronger. So that's basically creating European public goods. Now, is that Eurozone public goods, or is it Schengen public goods, or is it European Union public goods? Well, you know, on each of those dimensions, we have a call for different levels of public goods. I think the case for joint funding, for example, in the refugee area, or common border control, or even defense, has never been stronger than it is currently. But I accept the argument that that is not a pure Eurozone task. It is a European Union task, or even beyond European Union. I mean, we can very much imagine that EFTA countries, Norway and so on, may be interested in some of these things as well. So that creates a problem for stabilization. The stabilization function, and let me try to explain explain why. The problem with stabilization is that to do meaningful fiscal stabilization, you need meaningful expenditure categories. You cannot do fiscal stabilization without spending money on something. So you need to spend money on something. Typically, it's the social security systems. Typically, it's the pension systems. But typically, it is also public infrastructure spendings, joint public goods, and so on. And if you do not have these functions at the central level, you are basically left with the only option that is using national fiscal policies and national spending and national taxation for fiscal stabilization policy. Now, if you accept that argument, I think you will immediately accept the argument that we need to seriously coordinate national fiscal policies. And this, in a sense, is what we've been trying to do for quite some time. With mixed success. I think the issue is, of course, at the end of the day, is that we have national sovereign parliaments, national sovereign decision makers that want to run fiscal policies according to their national electorate preferences, but that is inconsistent with may be necessary from the Eurozone perspective. So I think we need to do more constrain on, in some instances, at least national sovereignty. But on the other hand, that may not be enough. So we may want to talk about building up some federal spending categories where we agree on jointly funded projects. I think, for example, a European unemployment reinsurance model is something that. You know, after a lot of hesitation, I would endorse by now. I think it's a very difficult thing, but as a reinsurance for big shocks, I could very much see that. Now, the last point is the sovereign debt restructuring. Let me just say, my starting point is a bit different from where José starts. José starts from the point, well, we cannot make a risk-free asset risky. My starting point would be to say the assets are risky at the moment. So we don't start from risk-free assets, we start from risky assets. We know that not all sovereign debt is risk-free. And so if we start from that, then the question is, you know, what is the realistic response to the fact that some of our debt is not risk-free? There is an answer given to this in the European Stability Mechanism that says if a debt is not sustainable, we cannot grant a bailout to it. And that basically defines that in some instances debt can be risky. So I think what we have to do is we have to accept that this is the case, and we have to build the right framework to be the best to be able to cope with that riskiness in the best way. And that, to my mind, includes building up things like large exposure rules on sovereign debt, but combining it with the simultaneous introduction of a deposit insurance and of a proper fiscal backstop for banking unions. So that needs to be simultaneous. And I think it also should go hand in hand with increased, more symmetric coordination for better stabilization policies, so that the likelihood of ending in sort of a debt deflation spiral that is still relatively high for the Eurozone gets significantly diminished, so that the risk event can be avoided. But, you know, I think the fact that there is a risk possibility, at least, we cannot deny that.
Thank you very much. We are a bit over time, so would you like to comment, or otherwise I would open it up to the floor for discussions. Okay, please. I would like to collect, I think, 3 questions at a time. Please.
Yes, I would like a question that is addressed actually to perhaps potentially to all the panelists. And it's about, much has been said about sequencing, especially by Jose and by the other. And linked to that, I think, is the awareness of limited political capital also on what you could do. So you could have a blueprint of a genuine EMU that includes everything. So there I have a question about what could realistically be done. If we start from what seems to be a common premise that banking union is the key and the most urgent priority. I take in fully the point that were made very well about the contingent fiscal union nature of the banking union. It's ex post stabilization capacity coupled with a very desirable absence of ex ante redistribution implications. So I think this was, could not have been said better in my view. However, I think point out by Guntram, in a sense, we had a banking union that was done a bit on the cheap. That is, the fiscal implications were kind of set aside because bail-in will be taken care, and I fully share, although this is not the official position of the institution, but let's say I have sympathy for the concern expressed by Guntram. So if we accept that, indeed, banking union has important fiscal implication, the point is, the conclusion may be that for the foreseeable future, we may be lacking the political capital to put in place other desirable feature. In particular, I refer to the point made by Guntram about, I understand that he just come around the view that stabilization capacity, some kind of unemployment reinsurance would be necessary. Well, I don't know. I think if we consider it is necessary, then it's difficult that we have it. So we have a bit of a dilemma. What is necessary may not be feasible. So I would like to hear what the panelists thinks about what are the limits and whether what is politically feasible then actually may be sufficient to sustain monitoring. And linked to that, an issue on the risk-free asset, very important, but again, if you are aware of the limits in setting up a fiscal capacity. Let's say, if banking union absorb all the political capital that is imaginable in the foreseeable future that could be put on a project of fiscal union, how could we create the risk-free asset? Would be a market solution like the SBIS enough? Or?
Thank you. Francesco, please.
Yeah, I have.
Excuse me, could you use the microphone because it's live streamed? Sorry.
So the first question is, if perfect banking union is the best shock-absorbing mechanism, do we kill the motivation for capital market union that comes from the idea that it's the equity market that is the best way to absorb shocks or mutualize shocks in the euro area? We have the banking union. If we have the banking union, we don't need capital market union for the purpose of shock absorption. And this is my first comment/question. The other one is about deposit guarantee scheme. I think that the SSM, the single supervisory mechanism, has not achieved sufficient homogenization of the risk of the banking sector in different countries. It has done quite something, but maybe not enough. And the main remaining issue, in my view, is what Guntram was saying, national sovereign bonds in banks' balance sheet. And this, in my view, stands in the way, or maybe is an excuse for not doing a common deposit guarantee. And I think that the two further homogenizing the risk in different banking system and deposit guarantee scheme must go together. And if you establish a precondition, you will never get to it. If you say it's in parallel, there is some hope.
Thank you. Marek, please.
Actually, I have a follow-up question regarding the fragmentation of financial market. Is it possible to think about complete homogenization of risk without respect to national borders as far as we have so deep decentralization of fiscal policy? When we have expenditure to GDP on national level between 40% and 60%, on union level less than 1%. So even if we have perfectly working banking union and capital market union, can the risk of national fiscal risk factor disappear from this equation? Because we assume that this national level, which takes responsibility, ultimate responsibility for its expenditure, then means that if we have problems on national level, fiscal problems, this is not only problem of banking sector. This, I agree, may be neutralized, but this is also a risk of much higher taxes, for example, national level. And it impacts expected rate of return in a given jurisdiction. So can we expect full homogenization of risk?
Thank you. Jose, please, if you like to comment, I would just go down the row.
Maybe on the banking union and capital markets union, I think they are complementary. They're not substitutes. I think in terms of the political capital available to move towards a complete monetary union, this political capital should be invested on completing the banking union and on launching a real capital markets union. Now, the capital markets union will take time because it goes into issues that are very deep into the national policy making, insolvency law, accounting standards, and achieving a sufficient level of harmonization of these things takes a lot of time. So what we should be doing is investing more in completing the banking union and putting in place the backstop, agreeing on a common European deposit insurance scheme. You can start with a very small reinsurance system and then gradually move towards a more mutualized construction, which is what the Commission has put on the table. I think this is the priority right now, more than steps towards fiscal union directly through any type of debt mutualization or putting in place a fiscal stabilization function through, for example, unemployment insurance schemes or whatever. I think, and that has been said by Fernando Navarrete, that completing the banking union has a huge fiscal stabilization effect. And that's the first priority that we should be investing our political capital on. Now, the debate on this has been framed by some in, okay, but this means risk sharing. And before you do risk sharing through the deposit insurance or the banking union, you need to do risk reduction. And one of the elements of risk reduction that they bring in is the issue of reviewing the way sovereign debt is treated in banks' balance sheets. And this links to the issue of the safe asset at euro area level. Now, I agree with those who say this, but these things need to proceed in parallel. Risk reduction with risk sharing at the same time. Also because elements of risk sharing contribute to risk reduction. When you put in place a backstop to the resolution fund, which is in a way a risk sharing tool, you are reducing the risks at the same time. So, but what I fear is that the debate is being framed in a way that is not progressing. And the debate is now between what should go first, risk sharing or risk reduction, and we've been discussing this for the last 3 months. And I'm afraid that nobody is actually discussing the Commission proposal, which is on the table on the deposit insurance. And if we continue like this, the objective of the current Dutch presidency, which is to have at least a first agreement at the political level in the Council by June, will probably be missed if this debate continues to be stuck. So this is the situation where we are. Thank you.
Thank you, Jose. I could not agree more with what you just said on this idea that risk sharing by definition is risk reduction. And this is a point that many times goes unattended. The question I wanted to address was this, you mentioned it was so the dilemma, what is necessary may not be politically feasible. I would ask the question the other way around. If it is necessary, then either we make it politically feasible and it would explode. And we tend to disregard the possibility that the European Monetary Union may eventually break apart. if we don't make possible what is necessary. And I think what is necessary is to have a fiscal backstop. As I said, and I tried to say in my initial comments, I cannot imagine, and I do not know, of any monetary union that works without a fiscal backstop in a fiduciary system. And that's the essence of the game, which we are. We do have an imperfect fiscal backstop, which makes then the union inherently unstable. Are we willing to run the risk of letting the system collapse? And that's a question that we may have to answer at some point. I mean, the way we have answered this issue, I have again a way to describe this to my students, and this is, you know, we in Europe have the tendency to put the cart before the horses. Then we realize 10 years later it doesn't work, that the cart doesn't move. And then before you break the cart apart, we decide that it's nice to put the horse before the cart and you know, try to pull the cart. We've done this in banking union. I mean, we, you know, everything we're talking about was deliberately ignored in the Maastricht Treaty. Not because we didn't know, we economists didn't know. It was because it was politically impossible to even mention those issues. But we all knew that, you know, and there's a quote by Romano Prodi, which is interesting, speaking at the European Parliament in 2000, I think it was 2000, he said, sometime there will be a crisis and then new political tools will be implemented to make the banking union possible. Then we've already done this. The problem is the crisis has been too large, too long and too costly. And your question is, do we need another crisis? Well, I hope not. I hope we've learned by now that we have to make politically feasible what is technically necessary, and that is the fiscal backstop. So that's one point I wanted to comment. The other very quick point I want to make on the sovereign debt restructuring mechanism and the debt, two or three quick points here. First, we tend to assume when we talk about the sovereign debt restructuring mechanism that there is such a thing as a technical definition of sustainable debt. And Guntram, to some extent, in a way, acted as if we can agree on what is sustainable debt. Well, let me tell you guys, this is not the case. I mean, nobody knows what sustainable debt is. So what we're saying, Guntram, is we will have to come out with a mechanism which will give one institution the authority to decide who gets paid, when they get paid, what is the size of the haircut, which creditors are privileged to some others. And this will be taken by an institution which will be granted with authority to declare a standstill and implement a compulsory moratorium on debt payments. By the way, this is exactly what the IMF SDRM mechanism under Ann Kruger, way in the 90s, was supposed to do. And it's gone with the wind. I mean, nobody talks about that mechanism anymore because it is just impossible. Another thing that we are now doing is, okay, see, we cannot do it politically, let's do it through the bank system. Because being the banking union is such a powerful, a silent mechanism of fiscal transfers, which then have this beauty that you described very well, that are not necessarily systematic over time, and they change, and it's very difficult to know 10 years from now who will benefit or not. And so it's not the rich subsidizing the poor, because nobody knows, you know, which financial system is weak at some point, unless we make the financial system being precisely weak because we will define that certain government bonds are riskier than others. And since they're riskier, banks in that jurisdiction will be forced to keep more capital aside to envisage the possibility, the self-fulfilling possibility, that this debt may eventually not be paid. Therefore, we will, by statute, decide that certain type of debt is simply not sustainable. Now, this is, again, another feature that no system in the world, no monetary union in the world, works with. Precisely because it will work hand in hand with the essence of a risk-free asset that José Leandro was saying. Because banks in that particular jurisdiction will not have the luxury to save, keep part of the reserves in a European risk-free asset, unless they decide to keep government bonds of another country. And in doing so, we will create an additional asymmetry, making it even more likely that some countries will default on their own debt. This is an inherently unstable, unsustainable system that simply cannot work. That was my only point. I have many other questions, but it's too late.
I would just like thank you for this opportunity to comment again. But I would like just to give full support to Guntram's idea, his belief that what is really written in banking BRRD, Restructuring and Resolution Directive, eventually won't happen as it is written. And I don't want to sound very technical, but I think it's very obvious that in the case of a systemic crisis, it's just by definition of what is systemic. It has to be that, if it's a systemic financial crisis, European-wide, it is impossible that the financial system itself can insure itself. This is the definition of what is systemic risk. Otherwise, it's idiosyncratic. So typically, deposit insurance paid by banks is a self-insurance mechanism that can afford idiosyncratic shocks within the system. If it's the system what fails, it's obvious that if the system is not to collapse, it has to be something from the outside the financial system, that puts money in. Otherwise, it won't work. This is just by definition. Who can that external guy be? Has to be government, unless we have Martians coming here to save the financial system. So this is just by definition. This is not just a belief. I think it's fundamental economics show us that this has to happen this way. So BRRD, as it is written, works fine for idiosyncratic crisis. In the case of a systemic event, defined as a pan-European systemic event, by definition, won't work. This is simple, and I think it's much more, in my view, it's not just a belief. I think this is just application of standard economics. On the question of whether idiosyncratic factors can be mitigated up to a point to disappear, my answer would be, of course, not. It does not even happen within the U.S., with this, a nation, with, of course, idiosyncratic factors are in there. Even within nations, we have regions with idiosyncratic factors. They will stay there and they will continue. Now, the key point is whether banks or market participants, whether can effectively diversify those idiosyncratic risks. And the question is, if we have a banking union and then allow, what Guntram also mentioned, banks to really operate cross-border freely in terms of free movement of capital, deposits, liquidity in particular, then these idiosyncratic shocks can be effectively diversified within the system. And that's not to disappear, but it can be diversified. So here again, just to link the three comments, my comment of banking union dwarfing any other mechanism, okay, if it dwarfs any other in terms of size, when it's activated, but it's only activated from time to time. It's not a regular and permanent system. So you have a two-tiered system, one that is basically, it can be capital market units, among others, buffering on a regular basis. But then if you have the big one, this system collapses, and then you have the big one that really cushions. It's a two-tiered system, completely complementary, as José Leandro mentioned. And I think it theoretically works. Politically, it's trying to break through. I've made a presentation, very vivid, tried to claim this is important for the next crisis to be much milder than the current we are trying to keep behind us. So let us hope this discussion helps for that matter. Thank you.
Okay, very quickly, let me advertise my paper, Which Fiscal Union for the Euro Area. I think a lot of the things we discussed are described in quite some detail there. Let me just say, make three very quick points. The first is, I'm a big fan of Capital Markets Union, also because of recent research by Marco Pagano and co-authors, who show that a financial system that is not just based on banks, but is more diversified, is more stable and has typically, the economies typically feature higher growth rates. it's a very nice paper that has been published last year. The second is on banking and the fiscal transfers. Let me just very quickly say, of course, the key issue is, yes, we want this insurance, but yes, we don't want this insurance to be ever drawn on. And the reason is very simple. We don't want to repeat what has happened in this crisis, namely, how many state aid cases did we have, Pia? We just counted that several hundred state aid cases, huge amounts of money that were used. And so I think the key priority must remain in the whole banking area to make the banking system more sound. And, I think that we have gone some way in this direction. I don't think we've gone the full way. The last point is on, what is sustainable debt? Fernando, you mentioned there's no a clear definition. It needs to be somebody to decide that. Well, I think we have, in a sense, a setup where we have that someone who decides it, and that someone at the moment is the Eurogroup that accepts yes or no whether to go for an ESM program or not, based on a recommendation of the ECB, the European Commission, and the IMF. And I think all I'm saying is, I want to give that Eurogroup a choice that if it really feels that debt is unsustainable, it has the ability to earlier do the debt restructuring instead of forcing countries into impossible adjustment programs as we have done in Greece. And I think that's the main point I would make here. And that decision, I totally agree, is a decision that is at the end of the day political, which conversely means if we accept that there is an ESM program, we make a political decision that debt is sustainable of that country, and that also justifies the use of the OMT program by the ECB, because there is a political decision, this debt is a safe debt, and so then the ECB can buy it. So that's my the reason why I'm defending also the OMT program. Then there was a quick question on the risk-free asset and the ESBs. So I have some sympathy for the idea of saying, we impose large exposure rules on sovereign debt for banks, but if banks hold a basket of sovereign debt, that basket is not subject to the large exposure rule, which would go in the direction of ESBs in a sense.
If I may, there is a small technical but very important point. The ESB presupposes tranching. So if you have the tranching, the ESBs are the so-called safe. So you have the basket, but it's only the safe part of the basket. You can accept this is very safe, this is fine, everybody will tell us, okay, the ECB can accept it as collateral, no problem. If you have the pure basket, then you made the point, it was made, we know that some debt is not safe. So you no longer have the safe asset unless, this I think is a big problem, unless you create some fiscal capacity for which I don't see the political capital. So to me, this is the dilemma.
Great. I would leave it to this. A lot of food for thought. Yes?
Very quick final comment on Capital Markets Union, because I think that, I think Capital Markets Union is fine. I think it's an important element left in moving towards an integrated financial market in Europe. But I don't want to expect, I would hesitate to come out of this meeting expecting a lot from Capital Markets Union to happen, because the difficulties are huge. And you mentioned some of them in terms of, we are affecting basic national legal rights, which have to do with consumer protection. The heterogeneity of financial products and the protection that the courts in different countries give to this product. So I'm just a little, I'm a little too happy to hear, Capital Markets Union will bring this equity, resharing, et cetera, but it will take very long time to happen, yeah. Very long time.
In fact, Bruegel wrote, Guntram and Nicolas wrote a piece on it calling it a vision for the long term. So I think many thanks for being here. Thank you for the interesting debate, and see you soon.